Welcome to the Concours d'Elegance. This is the definitive definition of classics and car. Every August, the world's greatest car collectors gather right here in Pebble Beach. And over the next hour, we're going to introduce you to some of those car owners. We'll take you to the auction houses where they sell these magnificent machines. And we'll even show you some of the headaches, the heartache, and the thousands of hours it takes to restore these cars. But right now, let's take you to the Concours. That sound. Music to a car lover's ears. The collectible car industry has motored into more than a hobby.
I'm lucky that my hobby is also my business.
We founded the company because we love what we do.
It's a multi-million dollar business, attracting fans from around the world. The costs involved to restore an antique car to its former glory can be tremendous. And the time it takes to nurture, nurse, and craft an automobile back to its original specifications, exhausting.
Preparing a car for Pebble Beach can be a 4, 5, even a 10-year process. You got to find the car that you really want to bring. Spend the time looking into the history so that when you, before you touch the car, you know you're doing the right things and only what really needs to be done.
So what motivates people who love cars, some on a budget, others who spend whatever it takes, to endure painstaking hours and hundreds of thousands of dollars spent on vehicles that are more works of art than workhorses?
It's a passion. It really is.
Once that bug bites you, then you're hooked.
It's an affliction. It's an obsession. Everybody here, we'd be lying if we said we weren't bona fide car people.
For those that love the challenge of restoring a piece of automotive history, competition is fierce. Events worldwide attract collectors who present their prized possessions. But for the serious collector, there's only one event. One event each year that is best of show. Pebble Beach, the Concours d'Elegance.
Well, if there's any place in the world where all car enthusiasts gather, then it's Pebble Beach.
The field of cars is fine as you could assemble.
Pebble Beach is something really special.
Consider it the Super Bowl, the Academy Awards, the World Series for car collectors. Stunning vistas, magnificent machines, stylish spectators, converging on the world's most beautiful golf course. Each year, on the third Sunday in August, 200 of the most meticulously maintained automobiles in the world take to the turf for this prestigious contest. What began 63 years ago as a sidebar to a road race through Pebble Beach's famed cypress trees is now a 3-day multi-million dollar festival. Judges rate the cars on their historic value, their racing record, the authenticity of the restoration and preservation.
The benchmark is originality and authenticity. The starting point is what the car looked like the day it rolled out of the dealership into the owner's, the first owner's hands, and how faithfully has the car been maintained or restored to that standard.
But above all, these cars are judged on elegance. Fox Business pulls back the curtain to take you backstage at the Concours. We will introduce you to collectors, restoration experts, and people who just plain love cars to find out what it takes to make a winner. And we'll show you who is in the driver's seat when it comes to making big bucks. Two of the industry's most prestigious auction houses have pegged their largest sales around this event, generating more than $500 million in just the past 5 years. And the big bucks don't stop there. Today's luxury automakers help rev sales using Pebble Beach as their stage to tease tomorrow's customers. Finally, you'll meet the winner of this year's Concours d'Elegance and the man whose dad's cherished Ferrari set a new sales record at auction. That's all coming up in the next hour of Pebble Beach Best of Show. Some car collectors love their car in its natural state with decades of patina, but others are willing to spend thousands of hours and huge amounts of money to restore a car to best of show condition.
So the cars we're looking at here, are these cars that have been restored, or there's a whole spectrum?
The cars we're looking at here, there's a variety of cars, whether they've been restored or whether they're preservation. In other words, they're in the original state they were in way back in the day, or partially restored.
Is a car more valuable if it's in its original state, or is it more valuable if it's restored to its original state?
No, that's a matter of opinion. Normally, a car that is in original condition, that's never been touched, never been painted in that, is very, very desirable in the collector world. However, a car that's been fully restored and made drivable, for example, this Aston Martin would be a perfect example of a beautifully restored car, but it's also a car that you would enjoy driving.
So let's talk about this Aston Martin. Whoever restored this, I would assume, dumped a great deal of money into it. Would that be accurate?
Yes. Well, as a matter of fact, I know the fellow who restored this, and I had the opportunity to meet him. He spent a lot of years restoring this car, and he did a lot of the work himself, did a gorgeous, gorgeous job on it, and he did it for the love of it. And basically now, he obviously wants to turn it over to somebody else to enjoy driving.
What are some of the basics of restoring? Would he have made money? If you're doing this as just purely investment, would you wish to buy it already restored, or could you make more money doing the work yourself, finding the parts or machining the parts?
There again, that's always a conundrum to answer that question. One of the things is that, first of all, the car that you buy makes a big difference on how much it's worth once you restore it. This particular car, it would pay to have somebody restore it for you because of the value of the car and the condition. There again, you have to have a budget to make sure that you don't go over.
So what advice would you give to people? You know, all of us have a car we love. It could be grandma's 78 Buick LeSabre up to, you know, I think it's a 1936 Mercedes Roadster. What advice do you give to the novice about getting into the hobby and just things you should be aware of?
Okay. First of all, you got to do it for the love of it. If you're going to do it simply to restore a car, just to do it to make money on, I think you're in the wrong business. You can do well on it, but I think you should do it first of all for the love of it. You got to enjoy what you're doing. No different taking a vacation. You come back with a bunch of pictures. Here you're going to have a car. So I really do believe that's the first step in it. The next thing is to buy the best car you can buy. The best condition, start with that.
What should you look for when you say best condition? I'm always looking at, is the engine running? How much of a rebuild would I have to do on the engine, or are there other factors?
Structure is a big part of it, and it could be a very, very expensive part. So chassis, floor, sheet metal, things that you cannot buy. For example, on some of these cars, you would have to make. If a fender was completely destroyed or rusted out, you would have to make it. So structure is very important.
Now, as the chief of, you know, the restoration department at RM, you're capable, if parts are unavailable, if sheet metal doesn't exist anymore, you're capable of actually creating
Absolutely.
To the original specifications?
Absolutely. We can create a fender, we can create a hood, we can create a roof, we can create a whole car if you want, and we've done so. As a matter of fact, we have one at Pebble Beach right now that we're going to be showing tomorrow, and it is a fully bodied car that we did everything, including the wood frame structure and all the fender, including the windshield frames, everything.
But when you do that, when you create new sheet metal or when you create new wood, is it the car?
It's still the car. The chassis is original. The car is built to the original specification. Is it a rebody? Well, maybe it is, but regardless, it's still it's still the car and the way it was when it was original.
Okay, and lastly, the time it can take to restore a car as we wrap up.
A full restoration can take anywhere from a year to 3 years, depending on how complex the car is.
Absolutely worth it?
Absolutely.
Millions of dollars roll through Pebble Beach during the Concours. Generating the biggest bucks are the auction houses that wheel and deal with millionaires and billionaires. Up next, we'll take you behind the scenes at two of the industry's biggest and most respected auction houses and show you why, when it comes to bidding and winning, they are best of show. Welcome back to Best of Show. For some collectors, it's a desire to find their first set of wheels, a 64 Mustang or 57 Chevy. For others, it's a desire to own a rare piece of history or artistic masterpiece. Names like Delahaye, Delonge, Hispano Suiza evoke a bygone era that is still within grasp for anyone willing to pay, thanks to the auctions that take place during the Concours. The Concours is about prestige and pageantry, and its growth as the world's premier classic car competition has attracted green to the green, money. Two of the industry's largest automobile auction houses, RM and Gooding, generate their biggest sales in the days leading up to the Concours. It takes on a fever pitch of
1.2, 1.3, 1.4.
Action.
1.9 million on bid.
Bids.
Sold your car, sir. Congratulations.
All right.
Cars. The past decade has seen sales grow tremendously for auction houses like David Gooding's.
We did our first auction here 10 years ago at Pebble Beach, and
It was the very first auction we did, and I can't believe the growth that we've had since then.
From $14 million at its premier Pebble Beach auction to $112 million in 2013, Pebble Beach has been good to Gooding. This year, 30 cars sold for more than $1 million. Gooding caught the car bug early. His father was curator of two auto museums. He thinks appreciation for the automobile has increased all over the world, and it's part of the reason for the growth in sales and prices.
When I was a kid, car people were distinctly car people, and they certainly are now, but I think there's a whole wide, globally, people understand that an automobile is an important historical artifact, that it can be an art form. It's appreciated for their craftsmanship, their history. And when I was younger, that was not the case. You know, automobiles were for people who had a mechanical sensibility.
RM, which hosts its auction in neighboring Monterey, saw sales hit a record $125 million during the Concours weekend. 26 lots sold for more than $1 million, and one of those, a 1967 Ferrari 275 Spider.
We're seeing collector cars being treated finally as true pieces of artwork. They're tremendously collectible, they're very rare, and for the finest cars that are out there, more and more people are seeking cars that they can use for a variety of purposes. There's also a lot more things you can do with these cars. There are driving events, racing events, concours events. Some people decide to show their cars, some decide to drive them, and in other cases even race them.
And at these prices, you may be surprised to learn that authenticity sometimes trumps perfection.
In the last 2 years, I would say the trend has really shifted. So you can see unrestored cars bringing as much or more money than restored cars, which has never before been the case.
Irrespective of whatever price point you enter the hobby, you want to make sure that you can get the best example in that respective category. It's a 66 Mustang or a 66 Ferrari. You want to be able to get the finest example, preferably with the right colors on it, attractive colors, the right body style, the right motor, and usually the highest specification. So find the most desirable and always do your homework. Find out if the car is correct, factory correct.
This fervent desire for authenticity has even led some unrestored cars with what they call patina. That's the natural brown film that shows up on the exterior metal of a car after years of oxidation to command high prices.
Why would an unrestored car that has its, I think you guys say, the patina,
right,
be attractive to a collector?
Well, because it's so interesting for us car enthusiasts to see exactly how they were finished, and that when they have the patina, they speak. It's, the cars have these textures. You can see all about their history. It's right there.
Like any commodity, when a seller can prove a rare and desirable car's authenticity, it's destined to become a blockbuster.
Single ownership tells us that the history is really bulletproof, and we know what's happened with the car from day one. But aside from that, it's also perfectly sorted, it's factory correct, it's a matching numbers car with its original engine. So you take all those components together and you have a really, really perfectly desirable car.
It cost them $14,500 when it was new. It will sell for several millions of dollars. It might even set a world record at auction. And when we come back, what the owner of this incredible Ferrari intends to do with the profits, that will really surprise you. In the 1950s and 1960s, Ferrari sports cars sent blood racing and hearts pounding, but nothing like the recent prices those same cars command at auction. One 1967 Ferrari was raising eyebrows years before it raced towards Pebble Beach. And even more incredible is the story behind Ed Smith and his family, the original owners, and why they decided to sell it. You're the owner of a 1967 Ferrari that could very well set a new record for a Ferrari sold at auction. I mean, multiple millions of dollars. Why'd you decide to sell it?
That's a great question, because it's been in our family for 45 years, so it's going to be a very bittersweet experience. But 2 years ago, well, let me back up. Dad picked the car up new at the factory with Luigi Canetti in 1968, and so it's been in our family all that time. He and I drove it to Sebring, Florida at least three or four times for the races. We just enjoyed the car so much over the years. So he never considered selling it, even though he had opportunities to sell it to a lot of people, some of them very famous people, who couldn't believe he was turning them down. But he's been dead for 6 years now, and he would take the car and use it, show it, let other people enjoy seeing it at concours and things like that. It's just really, I don't have the time to do that. And so it's really been imprisoned in my mind in a specially built garage in my airplane hangar for 6 years. And 2 years ago, we decided to, as a family, to take it to Savannah, Georgia, to the annual Ferrari, big annual national meet. And we put it in the concourse, and we were just amazed at people's reaction. And we realized that since there were only 10 of them on Earth, that most people had never even seen one. And people that know Ferraris know the NART and know its history, and that there's only 10. And we literally saw people weep at the concourse. And I thought, this just isn't right for the car not to be seen. It's not what Dad would want. And he would want it out in the hands of someone who would be using it as he did and sharing it with others on the one hand. And on the other hand, we've been so blessed by God in so many ways that we're in a position to give all the money away to charities, which he would absolutely love. He was reared in an orphanage, walked to the nearest town, was a taxi driver when I was young. But once his little business became somewhat successful, he gave away as much as he kept or more, and he'd really taught us to give back. So we're gonna give all the money to various charities that we know he would approve of and was involved in, and we think that'll make him very happy.
Let me ask you, you brought up something about the car. He drove it regularly.
Yes.
There are people who buy these beautiful machines and lock them away. It sounds to me like you think that's a mistake.
Well, I do, and he certainly did. One very famous car collector from New York, a clothing designer that I won't name, came down knowing he could buy the car from Dad. He's got one of the nicest collections in the world, and he really needed an art to round out that collection, and he knew he could write a check probably for more than my dad's net worth. And so he came down and said, well, can I see the car? And they walked back there, and Dad pitched him the keys. And he said, let's take it for a spin. And this gentleman literally almost passed out. He said, you drive it? And Dad said, it's a car. It's a special car, but it's a car. The gentleman would not drive the car. He couldn't imagine taking a car worth that many millions of dollars out on the road. So Dad said, well, give me the keys. Then he put him in the car and took him out of a little country road, scared him to death. But Dad always felt that way, and I think that's one of the reasons that the people in the Ferrari Club of America loved him so much. He loved Ferraris for the right reason, because they were made to drive. They're special, special automobiles. This one is one of the best driving and sounding Ferraris that's ever been built.
Does it ever just make your heart stop a little bit, though? You might set a record. This car may set a record for a Ferrari sold at auction. Does that just make you take pause?
Well, since we're giving the money to charities, I hope we set the record and break the record by a wide margin. But I didn't think about that when we made the decision to let the car go. We really just, it was driven by the fact that people needed to be seeing the car needed to be in the hands of someone that could use, enjoy it, and share it, and the fact that we could touch a lot of lives with the money that we get for the sale.
The $25 million sold! Thank you very much.
And did it ever. Eddie Smith Sr.'s $14,500 splurge back in 1967, it stole the show at Pebble Beach. That little red Ferrari set a record at RM Auctions Monterey sale, selling for $27.5 million, including fees, the highest price ever paid for a car at auction in the United States. The sale raced past the previous record, $16.4 million, paid for a car sold at auction in 2011. And by the way, it too was a Ferrari. The Smith family may have been sentimental about watching their family's prized treasure go, but they were thrilled to see the car sell for so much, especially since all that money will go toward benefiting various charities. We caught up with Eddie Smith Jr. at the Concours on the day after the auction, and, well, you can imagine, he was overjoyed.
Mr. Smith, congratulations. $27.5 million in your wildest dreams. Did you ever think you'd get that much?
No. Not in my wildest dreams, but I've had probably 100 texts and 100 emails this morning telling me that my father is holding a huge party in heaven this morning, and I believe that.
It's incredible. You just raised $27.5 million for charity. Do you miss the car?
Not really. I mean, we've had the car for 45 years, and it was time to let someone else own it so that it could maybe be in an atmosphere like this and be seen and appreciated more. So I made that decision in peace with that, and We, of course, the hammer price is what comes to us to go to charity, but we're going to be able to touch thousands of lives with that, and how can you be sad about that?
As the bidding was ramping up and you surpassed $16 million, tell me about your heart and what you were feeling at that moment.
Well, I honestly got a little panicky. I mean, $16 million would have been fine. It just wouldn't have done as much for charity as we would like to have. But frankly, I guess something inside me for Dad really wanted to break the record, and the record was 16-4. And if you remember, the bidding sort of stopped. It jumped from 10 to 16 and stopped. But I thought Max, the auctioneer, did a magnificent job of just staying calm and letting everybody in. That's really when the bidding started, once he got everybody back in the game. But my heart was not exactly at a normal pace right about that time, if that's what you're asking.
And when they got to $27 million, what was your emotional state?
Well, the emotions then, and I turned around and looked at my sister, I looked at the whole family, and there wasn't anyone that wasn't crying. And it was not, you know, tears of sorrow for the car, it was tears of joy for, I don't know anywhere but in America something like this could happen. I mean, you know, Dad didn't have a lot of money, he wasn't a wealthy man, and so for him to start out with a car for $14,500 and to be able to do what we're getting ready to be able to do for lots of people at that magnitude, it's overwhelming, and we were all overwhelmed. We had lots of people come up from the audience later who we didn't know, from Italy, from everywhere. All of them said they were crying. So it wasn't just us that was emotional. It was an electric, magical time.
Of course, the Concours d'Elegance is about more than just antique cars. When we come back, the world's top car producers come right here to meet and greet the elite and maybe strike a few deals. Best of Show goes to a classic automobile each year, but Pebble Beach also offers car lovers a glimpse of the future. Luxury car makers unveil their latest creations, and while enthusiasts may think they're glimpsing a mirage, in the case of Cadillac, it's a sight to behold. For years in the United States, Cadillac has been an iconic brand that people talk about, meaning luxury, and Cadillac has redesigned its vehicles to appeal to a younger audience. And joining me now to discuss that is Senior Vice President of Cadillac, Bob Ferguson. And this is the car that is driving sales now with the younger generation of Cadillac buyers. What is this?
That's right. This is our new vehicle called the ATS, and it's doing exactly what we hoped it would do. It's bringing younger buyers into Cadillac. In fact, the average age for the buyer of the ATS is 10 years younger than a typical Cadillac. It's doing very well with women. A quarter of the sales for this vehicle go to people who are 35 years or younger, and almost all of those have never owned a Cadillac before. And one other interesting thing is it's very popular on the West Coast, where traditionally Cadillac has struggled a little bit.
And the West Coast is crucial among the car markets, but I'm curious, the entry-level price point for this vehicle is what?
Well, it ranges from about $42,000 to about $52,000, depending on the package that you get.
Cadillac's demographic buyer, typical buyer right now, is on par with Mercedes, correct?
That's right. Our typical buyer is about 62 years old and, of course, rather affluent and more located in the central of the country. And there are great markets in the Northeast and, of course, on the West Coast, where we need to raise our sales penetration, and our new cars are doing that.
Well, let me ask you about, when we talk about sales penetration, the Concours, why is it important for Cadillac to be here?
I think it's kind of table stakes, like you would say in a poker game. If you're going to be a global luxury player, then you need to be here where great cars are displayed and show that your cars are very competitive and stylish and work for a luxury buyer.
This is the future, potentially, of Cadillac. It was just unveiled at Pebble Beach late summer. And tell me about this, the El Mirage. It's different dramatically from what we've seen in Cadillac in years past.
Well, this is a very cool car. It has the Cadillac design cues, and it's a car that is remarkable for its lightweight, stylish performance. It's 205 inches long, so it's back to kind of the big Cadillac. Yeah. Has a V8 engine in it, 4.5 liter. But even more than that, it has the touches. This car is very bespoke, Brazilian rosewood, and a style that I think you look at it, it almost looks like the car's in motion.
Well, let's talk about, when you talk about Cadillac design cues, for instance, the back lamps here. I mean, this is a Cadillac design cue, the straight, what I would call the rear view lamp, or the rear lamps.
Absolutely. I think anytime you look at a Cadillac on the road, you can spot this and you know immediately it's a Cadillac. And in every version, if you look, if you walked our dealer showroom, you would see that there is something very similar to that. That's a design cue for Cadillac. And when we go and test our vehicles, it proves to be very popular.
It's also, you said, 205-inch wheelbase? So it's a longer than we've seen in the production model so far, and I realize that this is a concept, but it's also very low to the ground, which improves stability and control for what is a sport coupe, is it not?
Yeah, it's absolutely a luxury sports coupe, and it's a little bit wider than traditional, a little bit longer. But, you know, that's the Cadillac heritage. When you think of Cadillac, you think of big, stylish vehicles, and I don't think we should shy away from that. Mm-hmm. And with this car, which I think our dealers would love to sell, We're back to that model.
So let's talk about that, because so often we see a concept from manufacturers and people drool over the luxury and the design and then it doesn't get built. Will this be built?
You know, the ELR, which we're coming out with in the fall, started as a concept vehicle and we stayed very true to that. I really like this vehicle. The early feedback on it is fantastic. And speaking personally, I mean, we haven't made a decision. I'd love to see a car very similar to this in our showroom.
Well, you're the senior vice president, and it will depend on customer reaction as it's now being shown throughout the country. But you could push for it, could you not?
And we'll push for it.
While Cadillac continues to set hearts racing with its innovative designs, Infiniti is racing to the future with technology like drive-by-wire steering that's first in the industry.
The steering wheel is not connected mechanically with the tires, wheels. It's electrically controlled, which means you can get just only necessary feedback from the road.
So on a traditional car, when I'm driving and the steering wheel is connected by linkage and a metal bar to the front car tires, when those tires hit a bump, I feel that in the steering wheel.
Yeah, you already feel the bump of the road, right?
Yes.
This completely you can eliminate unnecessary feedback.
So there'll be no more bump, there'll be no more pothole jerks on the steering wheel.
But at the same time, the computer only pick up necessary information for you. This means you can have a very precise steering wheel without disruption of any road, bumpy.
Infiniti design chief Shiro Nakamura incorporates engineering prowess with sophisticated styling in his work for the luxury automaker. His attention to detail and eye for clean, bold lines can be seen in Infiniti's products, like the new Q50.
Will we see this copied by other automobile manufacturers?
Well, I think it's the future of the automotive technology. This can be, I think, adapted, of course, not only for us. Mechanically not connected means you can put steering wheel wherever you want. For example, you can move very easy, much more freedom for design. So we have already did many studies how we can go innovative with design-wise.
The Concours recognizes Nakamura's talent, and it's one of the reasons he was asked to be a judge in 2013. Who knows, perhaps one of his designs may one day be best of show.
I don't know, but in 50 years later, our car will be on the lawn, and people will judge. That is my dream.
Corvette celebrating 60 years, and wait till you see what they got lined up for the next 60 years. Stingray is back when we come back on this special from the Concours d'Elegance. Welcome back to Best of Show. 60 years ago, Porsche unveiled a concept called the 901. But French car maker Peugeot objected, claiming it had naming rights. So Porsche simply replaced the 0 with a 1 and the 911. A legendary car was born, proving good design never goes out of style. When we talk about collector cars, it would seem that every time a Porsche rolls off a factory production line, it's instantly a collector car. Why is that?
Well, probably it is proven by the fact that we have built now since 50 years, more than 820,000 units of the 911, and still more than two-thirds have a license. So this is a car which has a very good residual value, and it is a well-known car by all the collectors, and we are more than happy to have a lot of customers not only own only one 911, but sometimes even more.
But it's rare for a mass-produced automobile to actually increase in value, and yet the 911 can do that. Why is that? Is it because of the Porsche brand? Is it the Porsche technology?
I think it comes down to the Porsche brand itself. It's still the most important reason why people buy our cars. But the brand and the image, of course, is influenced by the products and the quality and the sustainability.
Who is the brand, the typical purchaser of a Porsche in the United States? Is it the technology they're purchasing? Is it the styling? Is it the, you know, the incredible driving experience?
I think it's all of them. It's part of them. We have the 18-year-old guys as well as the 80-year-old guys. So we have the Top Guns as well as we have the proud patrons, if I may call them like this. And the 911 is the icon of our brand, and the form, the silhouette, the fly line, everything has merely not changed, but evolutionary.
The engine, the technology has changed, but the lines are the same.
The lines is the same, yes.
Is there any discussion ever in the boardroom at Porsche AG to maybe change that, or is that something you'll never mess with?
Well, our design always tells us it is, and I really can accept that. It is one of the most difficult design activities to develop a new design for a new 911. It should be, of course, at the first glance, clearly a 911, but at a second glance, it should be the brand new and the latest model.
And what will be coming down the pike other than the 911 in the next year or two with Porsche? What's going to be the future collectible automobile?
Well, you see, Porsche is currently in the biggest product offensive we have ever seen in our 64-year-old history. Only this year we are going to celebrate more than 18 world premieres, which we are going to present to our friends and customers of the brand.
Why is the North American market so important to Porsche?
I think it is one of the, it has been the most developed market in the recent years for the entire automotive industry, with more than 50 million registrations a year. It has been caught up by China now. They are very close to the same number. But here we have a very long-lasting history, not only for racing, but also for very long-lasting customer connectivities. And 911 always was a statement for customers here in America, and I think this car perfectly fits to the needs of our customers
and
here.
Why the Concours? Why is it important, and where does it fit in the scheme of motor shows throughout the world?
Well, I think it's surrounding, and it's a brand, it's an icon for itself in the meanwhile. Pebble Beach is something really special.
Bustling in on Porsche's territory is an American classic, the Corvette. America's iconic sports car first hit the roads in 1953. It signifies style and speed, pure American moxie.
It is sort of classic American sports performance. The interesting thing, though, is as part of global Chevrolet, as you travel around the world, this is a vehicle that's known around the world as well. So even though it's American in its roots, American in its origin, there's an appeal for it, whether you're in Europe or other parts of the world.
On American roads, the Corvette took a few years to get up to full speed, but by the 1960s, it was a winner. And this year, Chevrolet is drawing upon that past success with a newly designed Corvette Stingray.
You know, it's a very special designation, I think, and the brand was waiting a long time for a pretty special vehicle to apply it to. This vehicle in particular is probably the most sophisticated Corvette that we've ever brought to market from a performance standpoint, from a design, from a technology perspective.
You can get behind the wheel of this American hot rod for $54,000. And should you choose to become a member of this prestigious Corvette club, you'll be entering a select class of car connoisseur.
It is the pinnacle of performance for Chevrolet. It really has iconic status when you look at the evolution of the vehicle. It's a sales leader within the segment.
The Concours caters to car connoisseurs, but people who just want a sweet ride can attend auctions nationwide where the cars blow you away without getting run over by the price. The man behind Barrett Jackson and those incredible auctions joins us next on Best of Show. In Investors looking for a big return may want to look at the BJI, the Barrett-Jackson Mini Index. Now, like stock indexes, it's a mix of what you might call auto blue chips, a 57 Thunderbird, 67 Jaguar, 1970 Camaro Z28, and a few other highly desirable cars. Between 1992 and 2012, the BJI returned 9.6%. It beat the Dow and S&P 500. Barrett-Jackson Auction Company's Craig Jackson loves everything to do with cars, and his auctions are in their own right best of show. If you think collecting cars is a hobby only the 1% can afford, think again. The chairman and CEO of Barrett-Jackson has made a living off of America's passion for the automobile, and he's bringing collectible cars to the masses.
We sell cars, you know, sometimes under $10,000, but we usually start them around $10,000. In Reno, our average car price was about $41,000. So it's hard to even give you a car and restore it for that amount of money.
Craig Jackson's father co-founded the company, which held its first collector car auction in Scottsdale, Arizona, back in 1971. It kicked off a passionate following and a profitable business.
We've been on Speed, now Fox Sports, for 17 years. When I first did it, some of my competitors are like, oh, no, no, this is supposed to be done in the quiet room, and you're not supposed to do this out in the open. I'm like, why? Our average customer is 70 years old. We need to bring new people into the hobby. Now my average customer is in their early 50s, and on our ratings on TV, our numbers from 18 to 34 have grown astronomically. So there's younger people collecting.
Jackson insists collecting cars is more than just good fun. It can be good business.
It's beat the stock market. Now it's beating gold, but for a while gold beat it. We put it against the three major indexes, and over the long haul, collector cars, and we picked cars that are more of a commodity, where we have a lot of sales, six cars, and this is collector cars. Yeah, there's bumps in the road, but the cars always keep going up.
And he hopes his auctions ignite the passions of future collectors who are in it for more than just money.
First of all, you have to love the cars. Don't buy them just because they're an investment. Buy the best car you can afford. Buy the rarest car you can afford. Don't buy something that somebody just tells you that's the car to buy. It's a love affair.
You may know how much you're willing to pay for a car at auction, but how much would you pay to restore it? $1,000, $10,000, $100,000? When we come back, we'll show you why millionaires are willing to spend whatever it takes to restore a classic car, and then we'll put you in the driver's seat of a Concours Best of Show winner. Car collectors mostly agree that it's cheaper to buy a fully restored car than to buy one that you need to restore. They like to joke the headaches alone will take a toll on your wallet and sanity. But when money is no object, an object about to be lost forever can be restored to best of show condition. Decades after these cars first revved to life and their shiny coats of glossy paint weathered away, the restoration begins. It's a process well-known billionaire car collector Peter Mullen calls crazy.
I do. Insanity is probably not an overstatement, actually. Restorations are a real challenge and a real commitment, finding parts that are no longer made and sourcing them from some long-forgotten place. Sometimes you can't find the right part. You have to machine the part and get the blueprints to recreate it. So it's a big, involved process.
One that can take years and cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. Mullen has spent millions collecting and restoring cars. Jack Nothercutt has been down that road several times.
You know, it's amazing when you get into some of these old cars, the way they were thinking about how to do things. They were experimenting constantly on these cars, doing, frankly, very strange things to make them run.
This year, Nethercutt brought a 1933 Hispano Suiza J12 Coupe de Ville to Pebble Beach after a year-long frame-off restoration. His family, a six-time Best of Show winner, holds a Concours record. Jack dismisses questions about the cost of each restoration, saying he does it out of a passion for fine art.
Every car is different, and I appreciate every car in a different way. This one, the body style is frankly gorgeous, I think, anyway. And the other thing about this car is the engine. It is huge. It's a 9.5 liter. It puts out 320 foot-pounds of torque. I mean, it is a brute.
Auction houses like RM provide collectors top dollar and top quality restoration services, which Concours chairman Sandra Button says pays off when restoring a car for competition.
First of all, you got to find the car that you really want to bring. Spend the time looking into the history so that before you touch the car, you know you're doing the right things and only what really needs to be done. It's a long, drawn-out process, and unfortunately, in many parts of our hobby, there's fewer and fewer people that do certain types of work. So you may be sending your radiator out to be worked on, and you may have to wait a year for the person, the right person who knows how to handle the materials, to touch your car.
Peter Mullen prefers his own go-to team when he wants to restore a car, like the 1930 rare French racer he brought to Pebble Beach. Mullen hired Brian Hoyt, who's been restoring cars since 1986 and has a long history restoring cars for Mullen.
It's a big commitment to do these jobs. It's, you know, thousands of hours. It's not for everybody. You know, you really have to be able to stick to it. You have to be able to see, you know, the final product at the end. You have to be able to look at something and envision what it can be. And that's what keeps us going.
Mullen advises anyone with patience and dollars to think twice before investing time and money in these antiques.
Collect them because you love it and it does something for you. If they turn out to be a good investment or they turn out that other people think it's great, that's fine. But that's not a good reason to collect cars. There's not a good reason to collect except for the passion.
But even when money is no object and an owner restores a car to its precise specifications, there's no guarantee it's enough to win best of show.
The year that we won was a closed coupe, four-door, and it was a Voisin, which very few people ever heard of. Closed cars don't typically win. Four-door cars never win. Cars that you can't pronounce the name never win, and lo and behold, we did. So it was an absolute thrill of a lifetime.
Every winner has a story, and sometimes that story is decades in the making. This magnificent 1934 Packard convertible traveled a long road from Puerto Rico to Pebble Beach to become the 2013 Concours Best of Show winner. The expert restoration team at RM Auctions spent roughly 10,000 hours rebuilding this classic. Previous owners who found the rusting relic in Puerto Rico intended to restore it, but it was current owner Joseph Cassini III who saw a chance to save and make history.
For future generations, we're just caretakers, preservers. So, you know, can you imagine a car like that? When it came back from Puerto Rico, it was rusted, the interior, the springs were coming through the seats. Could you imagine just having this lost to history and not having a car like that saved? Such an important car of the 30s.
A true one of a kind, since this Packard was delivered 79 years ago with a custom body sculpted by famed designer Raymond Dietrich. It set another milestone at the Concours, becoming the second American classic automobile to win Best of Show in almost 20 years. All the others were European.
The European cars are very sexy too, but timing is everything, right? So this was the time for a good, sexy American car to win.
Something Cassini did 9 years ago when another car he owns, a 1938 German-made classic, won Best of Show at the Concours. Winning is an honor, but Cassini says preserving art and history, for him, is a passion.
I don't have the wherewithal to own all the great cars in the world at once, but I do have the ability to own some of the greatest cars of the world one at a time. So I think this is one of the great cars of the world.
Right now, somewhere, someone is tinkering and working on a car, preparing it for Pebble Beach. Those who compete and the thousands of spectators who swarm the green during the Concours Festival have one thing in common: an insatiable love of cars. It helps make the Concours d'Elegance auto collecting's best of show. For all of us here at Fox Business, I'm Adam Shapiro. Happy motoring.